As our heroes stage their plan, back at home, the Packs talk about Kate's disappearance with more on Funny Gross Out. Our heroes then get in this van after thwarting some incredibly stilted GTA models. Also, that old woman looks no more than 12 years old. Ugh. You know, let's get those Lionsgate animated cliches out of the way. Disclaimer, I am aware that Lionsgate has distributed some amazing materials such as the art and works of Wallace and Gromit and Shaun the Sheep, but those do not count for this. These do.
The 7 biggest problems with Lionsgate animated features. Horribly stilted animation. Celebrity voice actors. Wasted professional voice actors. Cliched as fuck plots. Dull, unlikable characters. Forced humor. And of course, relevance.
God, I'm just waiting for a twerking wolf any second now, but I'm getting sidetracked. Next, we've got Garth and Lily having more fun with toilet humor. When will the filmmakers realize that you don't need to use merely toilet humor to make kids laugh?
We stopped.
Yeah, again, that's an image I don't need in my head today. More toilet humor, and wouldn't you know it, the man pulls out a fucking gun and they get lost because of this fucking potty failure. I absolutely adore how this film has no idea what its target audience is. It's full of adult humor, but none of it is really funny or clever. They bring up disturbing concepts like ripping eyes and tails out, but it doesn't go anywhere. Yet, it still carries a PG rating. Huh. Still don't find any of this film entertaining. Yeah, you're one of the most unfunny protagonists I've ever seen in a kid's film. Look, I know even this film has standards. Very backwards standards. But I wouldn't mind it if they just decided to kill these two off. There's plenty of opportunities. The car could have run them over, they could have been struck by lightning, this guy could have up and shot them. It would be dark, but hey, anything to prevent an infestation of sequels. God, it's hard to keep track of these cliches, even if I write them down in the script. Wouldn't you know it, they survive, even with a quick Disney death. Oh, and there's a scene with Winston, but since it adds nothing to the plot, I'm just gonna skip talking about it.
Well, well, well. What do we have here?
These fucking geese?
I give you a first-class ticket home.
It's a straight shot right to the pin.
And you blow it?
Yeah. Over a cupcake.
No, you asshole. You had to take a piss, but the cupcake distracted you. Oh, and another lie. Maybe this is what I perceived, but that was a donut, not a cupcake. Naturally, the geese are upset over their failure, but they're still willing to help. They tell Kate and Humphrey that there is a train station with Canadian Express trains just on the other side of the mountain. So our heroes embark as Garth and Lily bond. I think this shot symbolizes just how bad the animation in this movie is. What more do I have to say other than, even the grass is bland!
Sure is pretty up there.
Yeah.
No, it's not. Maybe from your perspective it is, but from my end, all I see is a 2D image of a mountain superimposed in the back of this shot. These attempts to invoke scenery porn just make the movie worse. If anything, they show how cheap the animation is. Either way, Humphrey eventually bonds with this bear cub and they play around a bit until she starts crying. Suddenly a bear chase!
You guys like jokes? Good. So two bears are eating a clown. And one of the bears says, "Does this taste funny to you?"
You know it's sad when even this movie admits that its humor is tasteless and unfunny.
Where are those two?
Can we just get Patty and Marcel surgically removed from this film? Sure, maybe they helped Humphrey and Kate the first time they met, but most of the time they come off as whiny assholes who show up at the most inopportune times. Even besides that, I think there's one major problem with this scene. If the bear cub can talk, why aren't the adult bears talking? Where's the consistency? After this climactic battle, our heroes are whisked onto the train. How are there 32 minutes left? What more conflict do you need with this story? Well, Humphrey and Kate, as well as Garth and Lily, perfect their howling in pairs. but it ends quite sadly once the rest of the Eastern Wolves find out.
Howling with an Omega, are we?
Well, after looking into some mythology, I'm pretty sure that Garth and Lily hooking up would still work just as well at uniting the Pax, since Garth is still an Alpha. Maybe Pax in this universe can only be bonded if two Alphas mate, and that's probably how it works, but I don't know. Maybe they're just racist towards Omegas, but I think having at least one Alpha in a bond will work fine either way since you've still got a leader. So Humphrey has a conversation yet again with my two least favorite people. Fortunately, it doesn't last long, but this does.
Stop the insanity! Go organic! Stop the insanity! Go organic!
Well, I guess this confirms that they're either racist towards or just flat out disown wolves who think differently. So our heroes finally make it back to Jasper, but they discover the fight, and Kate goes to sort things out. They make it safely, but Kate's mom is pissed off at Humphrey. Kate then explains that she came back to unite the Pacts, and wait, this is treated as a good thing? So Humphrey reveals that he's gonna become a lone wolf and leaves Kate to get married. During the wedding, however, Kate reveals that she's in love with Humphrey, and Garth reveals his love for Lily. Naturally, both sides are extremely pissed off at this decision and begin to fight. Cue the stampede! Humphrey and Kate reunite somehow, as the last scene with him showed him boarding the train again. How'd he get back so quickly? The two go log sledding again to save Tony and Winston. Think of this as pretty much a combination of the climax of Toy Story and the stampede from The Lion King, so I'm counting it as a cliche. While Tony and Winston are okay, Kate is not so much. But everybody howls, and that seems to wake Kate up. Our heroes share their love for each other, and the pack leaders have a change of heart. So we end on a dance party ending where everybody sings. By the way, I'm so happy there's more cliches now than at the middle of the movie, so they're easier to keep track of. And that was Alpha and Omega, and I can't really say anything more, but I'll try. I have no plans on reviewing any of the straight-to-video sequels to this film, and if anything, they just get worse than this. And if you do like this film, I'm perfectly fine with that. I'm not here to tell you you can't like something, I'm only here to share my opinions. Unfortunately, I don't find Alpha and Omega a good movie at all. I think the visuals are bland and somewhat simplistic, the characters are uninteresting, and the story is incredibly dull and uninspired. I know that this film is a cliché storm, and while that may give the film charm to fans or they just don't care about him, these clichés are all played entirely straight. I think if a film is gonna use cliches, then there needs to be some subversion or I'm completely uninterested. This film just does nothing new with its material and just recycles ideas that have long since gone stale. I think the only positives I can say is that the film has decent voice acting and the soundtrack is okay, if not very memorable if you ask me. I know that there are people that enjoy Garth and Lily scenes together and yeah, they're tolerable, just not that interesting for me. If you want to see a good and quite frankly underrated reviewer tackle this film and its sequels, just check out Bob Show's channel. His reviews may lack humor in many areas, but he more than makes up for it with great points on what works in these films and what doesn't. Alpha and Omega. It's far from the worst animated film of all time, but it's still a pretty goddamn bland and pathetic one. You know, maybe I should review the open season films at some point.